shines with hope and grace, fills the sky with new mercy each day. We're alive. Let your glory pour out, Jesus. And there's a joy that overwhelms our souls, 'cause we know our God is in control. Overflow. Let your favor.
I need a miracle. What's got you barely hanging by a single thread? What looks so hopeless now? What weighs down your heart with doubt? You beg for a breakthrough, but no sign of breakthrough yet. When you've cried and you've cried till your tears run dry, the answer won't come and you don't know why. And you wonder if you can bow your head even one more time. Don't stop praying. Don't stop calling on.
crushed in spirit. The Alpha and Omega knows how your story ends. When you've cried and you've cried till your tears run dry, the answer won't come and you don't know why. And you wonder if you can bow your head even one more time. Oh, do it one more time. And don't stop praying. Don't stop calling on Jesus' name. Keep on piling on heaven's door. Let your knees wear out the floor. Don't stop believing. Cause mountains move with just a little faith. And your Father's heard every single word you're saying. So don't stop praying. Oh, no, don't stop praying. Oh,
don't stop praying for the prodigal. Don't stop praying for the miracle. Hallelujah, hallelujah, and amen. Don't stop praying that addictions end. Don't stop praying for deliverance. Hallelujah, hallelujah, and amen. Oh, don't stop praying for the sickness healed. Don't stop praying for his power revealed. Hallelujah, hallelujah, and amen. No, don't stop praying for the kingdom come. Don't stop praying that his will be done. Hallelujah, hallelujah, and amen. Don't stop praying. Don't stop calling on Jesus' name. Keep on pounding on heaven's door. Let your knees wear.
Bag on, and just when I ran out. No choice but to believe. My doubts are burning like ashes in the wind. So long to my old friend. Burden and bitterness, you can't just keep it moving. No, you ain't welcome here. No, hey, from now till I walk. Another one, I am free, I am free. Come on, sing it in victory. Sing, hell lost another one. I am free, I am free, I am free. Hell lost another one. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of your grave. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. I dare you. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Come on, you got a reason to get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. He gave me a reason to dance. Hallelujah. Gave me a reason to dance. Hey, he gave me a reason to dance. Hallelujah. Gave me a reason to dance. He gave me a reason to dance. Hallelujah. Gave me a reason to dance. He gave Somebody just give him some praise this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We give you praise, Jesus. Holy, holy, holy. Give you praise, Jesus. King of kings and Lord of lords.
A thousand generations fall.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. Oh, I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see. One more time, sing holy. We sing holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Lord, that's all we want is to see you high lifted up. Lord, we just want to see your glory today, Lord. Would you meet us here in a new way, God? We can't live off of yesterday's encounter, Lord, but we need a fresh encounter today. So, Lord, as we lift you high in this place, as we sing holy, holy is your name, as we lift you up with and join with creation and join with the heavenly host, singing holy is your name, Lord, would you meet us today? Lord, I pray that you would touch your people today in a new and special way, God. Lord, reveal your glory to us in new ways, Lord. And Lord, as we look up into the heavens, Lord, as we behold you, Lord, may your glory fill this temple, God. Lord, we just honor you and praise you for all that you are. Lord, without even asking anything of you, we just take a moment to praise you for who you are. For being a good God, for being a holy God, for being a righteous God, for being a just God, for being a loving God, for being a kind God. We give you thanks and we give you glory. And we sing, holy, holy, holy is your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Can we just give the Lord thanks this morning? Can we praise his name? Lord, we give you glory. We give you thanks. We give you honor. Hallelujah. Well, why don't you turn to a few people and say, God is good, and be seated.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Adam Shen. I'm the broadcast director here at Grace Fellowship. And thank you so much for streaming with us today. Whether you're watching at graceathens.com or you're watching on our YouTube channel, thank you so much for being with us today. Hey, if you're on our YouTube channel, give us a subscribe. And when you subscribe to our channel, it'll give you a notification every time we go live or we produce a new video. So thank you so much. My name is Adam Shen once again, and this is Grace News. If you're newish to Grace Fellowship, on the screen right now is a QR code. Take your phone out, scan that code. It will take you to a form just to fill out. Hit submit, and all we want to do next week is say thank you so much for joining us today here at Grace Fellowship.
Hey, it's Pastor Taylor here. I want to take a minute and tell you about our Rise Up Luncheon meeting that is coming up on April 21st at 12 o'clock, which will happen right after our 10:30 service in the Student Center. This is an opportunity for all of our rising sixth graders and their families to learn the process of what it means to go from children's ministry to student ministry, to learn what all student ministry is about, and an opportunity to meet and greet the amazing leaders that get to serve with your children every single week. So we would love to see you there.
Women of Grace, we want to invite you to our spring conference, which will be held on April the 27th from 8:30 until 2 o'clock. We will be serving breakfast, lunch, as well as providing childcare. The conference is going to be on John 15, where we abide in Christ. We abide in the true vine, we abide in his word, and we abide in obedience. We hope that you will come out and join us for this wonderful and amazing conference.
For more information about everything that goes on Grace, check out our website at graceathens.com and follow us on all our socials, Facebook, Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Right now, we're going into almost our most intimate time of worship. This is where you have a chance to give the Grace Fellowship. The reason why this is intimate is because this is a sacrificial part of our service. This is the most sacrificial part, where you get to give back from what God has blessed you with. So right now, I want you to take a minute, and on the screen right now is a QR code. Take your phone out again, scan that QR code, and it'll take you to our giving platform. If you are newish to Grace and you would like to know information about how to join the church, how to connect in small groups, how to serve the history of the church, then Next Steps is for you. We begin our first session next week. It's a 3-week session. And if you want more information about that, you can go to the website or you can meet Pastor Patrick out on the right side of the lobby this morning because he has donuts for you. We're trying to bribe you. And see, I even got the Next Step shoes on this morning. So we're ready to go. Yeah, you like that, Mr. Rick. Today, I'm going to continue in Pastor Tony's series called After the Resurrection. And what we're doing is we're taking these little encounters before Jesus is ascended, right after the resurrection. Pastor Tony talked last week about Thomas and about Jesus dealing with Thomas's doubt on a one-on-one basis. And today, we're going to look at Peter and dealing with the shame that Peter dealt with after he denied Jesus. The one thing these two men have in common is they both ran when Jesus was arrested. Even Thomas, who said, let's go to Jerusalem and we're going to die for him. When dying got real, they all ran. So if you have your Bibles, turn to John chapter 18, John chapter 20, and John chapter 21. But while you're turning, I need to get something off my chest, if that's okay. There is a problem that's sweeping across our country, and it's been going on for years, and this is a plague, and it's called reality TV. That was a joke. Y'all can laugh. Reality TV. I do not know how sensible adults watch reality TV. It's not real. Behind the camera, there are producers feeding scenarios, feeding lines to these people. Now, I'm not going to get in my wife's business too much because my wife is awesome. She is my best friend. She's the best person I know. She's a great mom. She's intelligent. She's a great wife. She looks good. Got to say that. She does great at what she does for a living. But every time I walk into our bedroom and she's vegging out on one of these shows, my respect level for my wife goes down just a touch. You know, I know all of it's fake. All of it's fake. But can you imagine having a camera follow you everywhere you go with unlimited access? There is not a person in this room or watching online that would want every detail of your life displayed for the entire internet. There is something in your life you would like to say, this isn't getting out on the internet, this isn't getting on the front page of the paper. Yes, they still print papers.
this is personal to me. I'm embarrassed by this. Now imagine you're Peter, and the worst thing you did in your entire life is in every gospel. Now let's look at John chapter 18. And let's set it up. Jesus is arrested. Peter goes to fight. He chops off somebody's ear. Jesus stops him from being killed. And then Jesus heals the ear. And as Jesus is taken off, all the disciples run. Every one of them. Then John and Peter, they decide after it was safe to come back and follow at a distance. And then John goes in. In John chapter 18, verse 17, the servant girl at the door said to Peter, "You are also not one of this man's disciples, are you?" And he said, "No, I am not." Now the servants and officers had a charcoal fire because it was cold. They were standing and warming themselves. Peter was also with them, standing and warming himself. Now I want you to think about this. So I don't know if we think about this. He just fought these people. He just took a sword and swung it at one of these guards. And now he's standing, warming himself by the fire with them. Did he not think they would recognize him? And then if you skip down to verse 25. So these officers said to, "You are also not one of his disciples, are you?" And he denied it again, "I am not." And one of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" And Peter denied it. And at once a rooster crowed. Peter, the rock which Jesus was to build the church. Jesus gave Peter that name, Peter. Now he has just denied him three times. And he let his master down. And he let all his other disciple pals down. Because he was supposed to be the leader. And he has to live with that. And he has to live with the shame that he denied his Lord three times. So what does this say about Peter? That he's human. He was scared. When dying got real, he ran and he lied. 3 weeks ago, Pastor Tony talked about these 12 ordinary men. These were extraordinary men. When things got real, they ran. And in chapter 19 of John, Jesus is crucified. And now if you turn to chapter 20, let's look at it. He was like, he's alive. He's risen. Peter and John run to the empty tomb. He appears to the disciples twice, once without Thomas and one with. Then he deals with Thomas's doubt on a one-on-one basis, but not with Peter. He doesn't deal with Peter's shame. And in John chapter 20, verse 30, it says, "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these were written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." Have you ever watched a movie and it's got like 10 minutes left, and you're like, how are they going to wrap this movie up? There's no way they're going to close all the loops, all the open-ended stories. And when you're reading this part, and you're like, John, wait a second. We haven't dealt with Peter. This is open-ended. Marvel, in every Marvel movie, they have a post-credit scene. And that post-credit scene does one of two things. It either wraps up loose ends, or it sets up the next movie. And that's what John chapter 21 does. It wraps up the loose end of Peter. And it gives the apostles a new mission. The disciples are sitting there going, what now? What are we supposed to do now? We've seen him twice, but he hasn't told us what to do. And Peter is dealing with that on top of him denying Jesus that he hasn't dealt with yet. Yes, he's seen Jesus twice and he's seen the tomb rolled away, but he has not dealt with his shame. And so what does Peter do in John chapter 21, verse 3? He says, "I'm going fishing." And they said, "Okay, we're going to go with you." And they went out, they got into the boat, But that night, they caught nothing. Every time I read scripture, Peter is just like a really bad fisherman. That's why he became a pastor, I guess. And so let's look at it. Why did Peter go fishing? During the research for this message, I watched several messages by well-known pastors and read articles and read commentaries. And to find out that question, why did he go fishing? And there were several different opinions. One opinion was he was giving up on his calling and he was going back to do what he had done in the past. He was just giving up on Jesus. He was being disobedient. Another one was he really didn't believe that Jesus had resurrected, even though he'd seen him twice and saw the empty tomb. Another one was Peter was being a very bad example to the other disciples. He was leading them back to their old life. And maybe all those pastors were right. But what if Peter just went back to the only thing he knew what to do? He was dealing with overwhelming guilt and overwhelming shame. And then on top of that, he didn't know what he was supposed to do with the rest of his life. We've been there before, right? Where you're dealing with a situation in your life and you have no clue what to do. You haven't got any direction from the Lord, and you're lost. Or maybe you're dealing with some kind of shame that's in your life that nobody knows in this room but you. Now imagine you're Peter and you're dealing with both of those at the same time. So what do you know? Fishing. And maybe he wanted to be alone when he went fishing. But he didn't have the heart to tell the disciples, his friends, to stay off. Because have you ever been in your prayer time and the Lord just kind of sneaked things that he's done for you while you're praying? You remember those things that he'd done. And maybe that's what's happening on this boat that night. Because on that boat, he met Jesus for the first time. And when he heard the words, "Come, follow me," was on his boat. He heard the first message he heard Jesus preach was on his boat. He calmed the seas on Peter's boat. Peter walked off of his boat onto the sea to walk to Jesus. Maybe this was the place, the one place that Peter knew he could serve God and Jesus the best was on his boat. Because it was on that boat when Jesus got in it, he saw miracle after miracle after miracle. He even saw his mother-in-law healed. I don't know if Peter counted that as a miracle, but he saw her healed. He saw 5,000 people be fed because Jesus got in his boat. He saw the dead being raised because Jesus got in his boat. His life was changed because Jesus got in his boat. And maybe he was trying to relive that. But maybe as he's reliving that, he hadn't dealt with the shame of the denial. And so maybe he's reliving that. He says, I saw all of this. I saw all of what God Jesus did for me, and I still denied him. Imagine you're Peter. Guilt is being sorry for something you've done, and to repent means to say that I'm sorry and I was wrong. But shame goes beyond that. Shame says, because of what I've done, I am now worthless. Imagine you're Peter and you're dealing with that shame. He's probably saying, now I'm worthless. There's no way that I can lead these men. Jesus don't love me anymore. I'm worthless. Shame stops your dreams in its tracks because now you just don't want to chase them anymore because you're ashamed of something that you've done. Shame stops you from living your fullest life. And that's what Peter had stopped living his fullest life because he was ashamed of what he had done. And when you see yourself as worthless, you don't understand how other people can love you. Because you don't love yourself. And that's how relationships end. And maybe that's what Peter was dealing with. He was ashamed. And self-punishment can be harder than any judgment a judge puts on you. Shame. When you've lost your job and you have to move out of your house. Shame. When you couldn't make that marriage work. Shame. When you were not a great witness to that friend and they ended up not following Christ because of something you did. Shame. When you will live with the sins of your past, even though you've been forgiven, you know that the past is the past and it eats at you. It's shame. When you live with that secret that only you and Jesus know about, it's shame. In the summer of, in May of 2012, I had been away from our church in Kansas for about 2 months. This was before we moved here. And I was going on interview after interview after interview. And nothing was working out. And we got contacted by a church in Maryland right out of D.C. And they contacted me. I had no clue who they were. And they wanted me to talk to me. They interviewed me for like a month and a half. And it was going great. And they said, Adam, we're going to fly you in. We're going to stop all other interviews. You're the guy. We're going to fly you and your family in. So they fly us and our two boys in. Montana was still a year away. And they came. We flew in on a Wednesday. I got to speak to their student ministry. The church was about 1,500 people. They met in a theater. It was a trendy church. It was awesome. They were going to hire me as a student pastor and the outreach director, something I was really good at. And I was excited. I preached to the students. Students got saved. It was awesome. It was an awesome day. We got to go see the Avengers in the afternoon. That was another story. But then that Friday, my mom called and said that my grandfather took a turn for the worse and that he wouldn't make it past the next week or so. And so I started pulling my phone out and checking it every couple minutes. And I got distracted. And I blew the rest of the interviews because I was distracted. I get on the plane Sunday after going to an amazing church service, and they hadn't offered me the position. And when you get on the plane after a week-long interview and they don't offer you the position, it's probably not going to work. The executive pastor who I had gotten close to over the last month, a month and a half of interviews, we got really tight. He called me on the tarmac. And as before we took off, and he said, man, I really hope you get it. And I said, me too. But both of us knew it wasn't going to work. The pastor called me the next day and said, hey, we're going to have to start our search all over again because this just didn't work. I was ashamed because I blew it. I didn't know what God had for me next. I was 34 years old. I still wanted to be a student pastor. I thought I was still pretty good at it. And I was ashamed because I couldn't feed my family. Sue was the only one working. We were burning through our savings. And I was ashamed. I stayed at home. I went to a couple movies by myself. I've never done that before, nor since. I didn't go work out with my buddy, my best friend Dan. And I was dodging his text messages. And phone calls. I just didn't want to talk to anybody. I didn't want to get out of my house because I was ashamed. And I get a text message, and it was from Dan. And Dan said, we have a tea time tomorrow at 10 a.m. I'm not taking no for an answer. So I show up, we hit off the tee, and Dan was a really horrible golfer, and I could just beat his brains out then. I can't now. And so we're on the first hole, and I'm like, Dan, I don't know what to do. I don't think God's going to use me anymore. And I can take you to the spot on hole number two. He looked at me and he said, Adam, are you really called to student ministry? Really? And I said, yes, Dan, I am. But I don't think God will use me anymore. And he looked at me and he said, be patient because God still wants you. 1 week later, I interviewed with Pastor Tony. Because when we go through those types of things in our life, sometimes we self-medicate. We want to drown the pain. And that's what I was doing. I was drowning my pain of letting my family down and not knowing what I was going to do. And I stayed inside. I didn't want to go anywhere until I was forced out. But we do that. We do that with alcohol. And we do that with drugs, and we do that with sex, or we pour ourselves into our work and we become workaholics because we're ashamed of something we've done. Or maybe we use church to hide our shame. To get that, we raise our hands, we shout, we worship, and we haven't dealt with the pain. And so how do you deal with shame? How do you deal with not knowing what God wants from you? Maybe you just need to do what you know what to do. Let's go fishing. Come down to these altars and say, God, I don't know what to do anymore. I'm broken. I'm lost. I can't do it. And maybe that's what Peter was doing. He was going to the one place he knew where he could serve God the best, and that was his boat, and he went fishing. Because when you come up and you give everything to Jesus at the altar, that's when he says, I got you. When you're broken, that's when Jesus wants you to, God got you the best. And to top all of this off that Peter was doing, all of this that he was going through emotionally, he didn't catch anything that night. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples didn't know it was Jesus. And he said to them, friends, do you have any fish? Literally, Jesus asked from ashore, have you eaten yet? And they answered, no. And he said to them, cast the nets on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. Have you ever been working on a project, and you've been working really hard, and you're not getting anywhere, and somebody passes by your office or something? Hey, if you do something, do just this, it'll work. And you either do two things. You either thank them or want to punch them. Now, I might be the only one that's up here, and I'm going to be honest, I don't want to punch them. But Jesus was doing two things here. He was either testing their faith because this procedure that he told them to do was not used by Galilean fishermen. Now, I don't know the procedure because the smart people that I read that out of the commentary said that, so I'm going to trust them. But maybe they didn't even know it was Jesus. They didn't know it was Jesus. So the one that I think was possibly was that Jesus had a better vantage point. That's a whole message by itself. But when you're dealing with shame and you're dealing with not knowing what to do, maybe you should trust Jesus a little bit because he sees everything you don't. And maybe he saw the school of fish on the right side that they were missing because they were right on top of it. And he saw it from the shore. So they cast the net in, and they were not able to pull it in because of the quantity of fish. And that disciple whom Jesus loved, therefore said to Peter. Now, I love that John calls himself the disciple that Jesus loved. My grandmother's funeral was 2 months ago, and I stood on the platform, and I said, hi, my name is Adam Shin, and I am my grandmother's favorite grandchild. I had the platform. They didn't. They were my cousins were the only ones that did not laugh. If they wanted to say that, they should have come to the pulpit. But that's what John is saying. This is my book. I'm going to refer to myself how I want to be referred to, and Jesus loved me. When John said, "It is the Lord," Peter heard it was the Lord. He put on his outer garment, for he had stripped it. He was working in his boxers pretty much. And he threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came into the boat, dragging the nets full of fish, for they were not far off from the land. They were about 100 yards off. When Peter heard it was the Lord, he lost all of his senses. He grabs his garment, puts it back on, and jumps in. Why did he do that? Why didn't he just jump in, and when the boat got to shore, he got his garment, he had something dry? Or maybe he just waited in the boat with the other disciples. But he jumps in, leaves his boys to get this huge pile of fish. Because sometimes when we're in the presence of Jesus, we lose all sense. We just want to be in his presence. Pastor Stephen Furtick from Elevation Church said this, and I loved when he said it, and I started thinking about it. He said, "Did Peter jump in, or was he pulled in?" Because maybe that night Peter was not the only one fishing. Maybe Jesus was on shore knowing that Peter was dealing with all his grief, all his shame, and what to do next. And Peter's broken at this point. And that's when Jesus said, "Okay, now I got him. Now I'm going to reel him in." Maybe when you're stuck and you're dealing with shame, maybe the altar is where you need to be. Nowhere else but the altar. An altar at your house, an altar at the golf course, an altar right here. Because watch the next verse. "When they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid out on it and bread." Jesus had already supplied everything they were working on that night, plus bread. He was giving them more. And think about it. All the disciples, all of them ran. Maybe all of them were dealing with some kind of shame, even though they had been around Jesus. Maybe they were still dealing with the own shame of running. When I was on that golf course, I didn't know Grace Fellowship was a week away. And all I said at that golf course was, Okay, God, I'm going to give this to you. I know you've called me. I was broken. What does Jesus call them when he yells out from shore? He called them friends. The same 11 men, there were only seven at that time right there, the same men that ran away when Jesus needed them most, he still called them friends. Because they were 11 extraordinary men that Jesus used to change the world. It's awesome how God uses imperfect people, you and me. He used Abraham. Abraham was old and he lied to get out of trouble. Elisha was suicidal. Joseph was abused. Job was bankrupt. Moses had a speech impediment. Gideon was afraid. Samson was a womanizer and really violent. Rahab was a prostitute. The Samaritan woman was divorced. Mary was just a teenager. David was an adulterer and a murderer. And God used imperfect people to accomplish his perfect purpose. That's what he does here. That's what he's doing with the disciples. And now it's time to restore Peter after breakfast. Restoration in the Webster Dictionary means this: a bringing back to a former position or condition. On the screen is going to be a restored 1967 Ford Mustang. It started up at the top, and below, that's the finished product. It was restored to almost brand new. Now, I can't restore that. I can't do that. If I did, I didn't have the patience, couldn't have the patience to do it. So I just need my wife to buy me the newer, the restored one, because that's my dream car. But it was made like new. And now this sets the stage for the restoration of Peter. Jesus asks him three times, "Do you love me?" And each time it's different. We can't get into all that. We don't have time to get into all the meanings of the words that Jesus used. But he asked him three times, "Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me?" And the simple reason why Jesus did that was math. Because Peter denied him three times. And Jesus is saying, Peter, I love you. I still love you. I still want you. And you are still the rock from which I'm going to build my church. I heard Pastor T.D. Jakes say this. He goes, when he said, I still want you. And I thought for a second, doesn't still imply that Jesus stopped loving him? But then I thought about it a little bit more. And if he was going through shame and he didn't know what else he was going to do with the rest of his life, because shame makes you question how anybody could ever love you. And Jesus is on that shore going, I still love you, Peter. I still want you. You're still my rock. I still love you. And Peter would be the first person to stand up and preach a message. There were 3,000 people got saved on Pentecost Sunday. And he was the leader of the church. And he went on. You could read about his stuff that he did in Acts. And then read his two books. And none of that would have ever been possible if he didn't go fishing that night in John chapter 21. Because biblical restoration is this. Number one, when God takes something broken and makes it brand new. When God takes something broken and makes it brand new. But here is my favorite one. The process of receiving back more that has been lost, such that the final state is greater than the original condition. When Jesus restores Peter, he increased his value. Pablo Picasso painted a painting in 1932 called Le Rêve, which means the dream. And he loved that painting, but in 1941, he sold that painting, Le Rêve, the dream, for $7,000 to a family in New York City. And this family in New York City put Le Rêve on their display in their gallery for 56 years until they sold it to Stephen Wynn out of Las Vegas for $50 million in 1997. And Steve Wynn loved this painting. He had a history with it. He had gone to New York to see it, and he just loved this painting, and he wanted it. And he displayed it in all of his casinos. And he was building a new casino in Las Vegas, and he wanted to name that casino Le Rêve, the dream. But he decided against it. But he always had it displayed somewhere in his casinos, and he loved it. Until 2006, he sold the dream to our friend, the new owner of the New York Mets, for $139 million. Which at that time was the largest painting purchase ever. So Stephen loved this painting, and before it went final, he had a party for it. And so Stephen puts his painting back up. If you'll put the next slide up. He puts it there on a platform, and he has a party. He has his friends and he has his family. And he's talking, and he gets the microphone and he's talking about his dream. And as he's talking about his dream, he was born with an eye condition that affected his peripheral vision. And he got a little too close to the painting. He stumbled and put his elbow through it. $139 million off. $89 million profit gone because he put his elbow through it. A silver dollar hole in the most expensive painting in the world. So Stephen scoured the world for the best restorer. And he found the restorer and paid this man $100,000 to restore his dream just so he can still have it. So he could display it. And it took the master restorer for a while. But then He restored it. And this is why an art buyer said, if you didn't know it had been damaged, you wouldn't have seen it. It was superbly restored. And in 2013, Stephen Wynn sold it back to Stephen Cohen for $155 million. $16 million more than what was originally agreed upon, because it was restored greater than the value of the painting. And when Jesus restores you, he restores you to something greater than you ever were. And the only thing you could see about the dream that even remotely showed that there was a restorer was if you turned it around and you could see where the master restorer had worked. And when you turn your life around and you see where Jesus had taken your pain and he's taken your shame and he's done all this stuff in your life, you have been restored masterfully. And that's what Peter was right here. He was restored to something bigger than what he ever was. Because we serve a God who sees our mistakes. He sees our shame. He sees our turmoil and our pain, and he rushes to embrace us. And when Jesus walked with Peter and Peter found himself overwhelmed by shame, Jesus proved again and again that he still wanted him and he still loved him. Pastor Tony's last point from last week was this: Jesus cares tenderly for us. And that's what Jesus does here with Peter. He doesn't chastise. He just says, Jesus, he says, Peter, I still love you. He says, Peter, I still love you. No matter the shame, no matter what you're dealing with, I still love you and I still want you. And from that moment, Peter's life was changed. He was restored to something greater than he already was, because the master restorer restored him. And I believe the Holy Spirit wanted me to tell someone in this room this morning that no matter your pain, he still loves you. No matter if you're lost and you don't know what to do next in your situation, he still loves you. He still wants you. No matter if you're ashamed from losing a house, or you're ashamed from losing a job, he loves you. So what I want you to do, if everyone will stand, we're going to reprise that song, Hold Me Forever. And we're just going to sing it together as a congregation. And if you need to come down to these altars and just say, okay, God, I'm broken, come. The altars will be open. But know this, before you walk out of this room this morning, he still loves you.
Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name stands above them all. Your name is the highest. Your name
One last time, sing, give me.
Last thing Jesus says to Peter when he is restoring Peter is the same words that he said to him when he first met him. Come, follow me. He totally restored him, and he looked at the man that denied him and said, I still love you. If you are newest to Grace and you want more information about Grace, about next steps, please see Pastor Patrick at the Next Steps booth today. He's got a donut for you. Thank you so much for allowing me to sub in for Pastor Tony. He'll be back next week when he's talk about the walk to Emmaus. Everybody have a great day.